Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
What a glorious day outside. It's so nice to see you all here. We are coming to you from the First United Methodist Church, for those of you who are tuning in on television or on YouTube later. But we'd like to thank all of you that are here in person as well, and we hope that you will have a wonderful Sunday. I have a few announcements to lift up. My name is Donna Boardman. I'm the lay leader of our congregation. And this is Pastor Paul Copeland. And we have a few things that we'd like to say. First of all, thank you so much for packing the place. We've got, as you can see, tons of things down here. There's still room for more. So if you forgot to bring your food or non-perishable things this morning, you can sure bring them into the office, and I'm sure they'll be glad to take them. We have a couple of other things going on. Of course, this week is Ash Wednesday, and that will be Wednesday, March 1st. And at 12:15 p.m., we'll be having worship in our chapel. And then also at 6 p.m., we will be having Ash Wednesday services here in the sanctuary. Now, that's a little different time than we had had last year, so make sure that you mark your watch, your calendar, or whatever, your phone, whatever you need to recall that, so that you will be here at 6 p.m. or 12:15. He Chose the Nails, What God Did to Win Your Heart, is this year's theme for our Lenten study that Pastor Paul is leading. That, too, will be held on Wednesdays. That will begin on March 8th. And it will run until April 5th, and it is held at 6:30 p.m. Chapel service will be those same days, except the 29th, at 6 p.m. in the chapel. So you can go to chapel and then go on to the study. And we always have a great time during those studies. It's nice to hear all the things that, you know, when you're studying by yourself, it's one thing, but when you do that all the time and you're not in conjunction with other people, soon they say, this is an old saying, you begin to look like God yourself. Well, we don't want that. We need to learn from each other and share in fellowship and bounce those ideas off each other. So I invite you to come to these studies on Wednesday night. The Melody Makers are looking for a bell player. And so if you know how to play bell or you would like to learn how to play bell, see John Sayers, and he will take care of that for you and put you where you need to be. We also have a couple of announcements from Mrs. Helslander and Mrs. Green. So, Mrs. Green, could you please come up? Thank you. I hope you all have a great day. God bless you.
And I'd like to send my thanks to these people, and I would like to send my thanks to Mr. Stapler. He was wonderful, and he helped in the kitchen very, very good. And also my Naomi Circle, they backed me 100%, and I appreciate all of them. And also these ladies, Rita Ellsworth, Carolyn Tugger, Phyllis Isaac, and Phyllis Jameson, and also you. Yeah. And I would like to thank all these people who donate cakes and salads. I couldn't have done it without y'all. And so I appreciate everyone that participate. And thank you very much.
Good morning. United Methodist Women will begin their 2017 year with a meeting on Thursday, March 9th. A luncheon will be served by Naomi Circle at 11:45. Our speaker that day will be Lola Ron. She and her husband Ryan have created a support group for foster parents in Atkinson. Lola will explain how they got started and what they do. Part of their program is to provide diapers, toddler clothing, and other items that foster parents may need. Naomi Circle is asking our UMW and members of our congregation for donations of diapers, sizes 4 or 5, or good used or new toddler clothing, sizes 3T and up. A box has been placed in Fellowship Hall for your donations. Your help for this worthwhile ministry is really appreciated. Thank you.
Good morning. I want to remind the Board of Trustees that we'll be having a meeting immediately after church this morning in Price Lounge. So trustees will be meeting in Price Lounge after worship today. Would you please take a few moments to greet those around you today? Oh, the bells will play first, won't they? Yeah. See, last time you messed up, this time I messed up. As the bells play the introit, let us turn our hearts and our spirits unto God. Please turn in your bulletin to the call to worship as we read responsively. The Lord is sovereign, let the people tremble in awe. The Lord is great in Zion and is high above all peoples.
Proclaim the greatness of the Lord our God and worship the Lord upon the holy mountain. Our hymn of celebration this morning is number 559, Christ is made the sure foundation. Please stand as you're able and join in singing.
Our opening prayer this morning is found on page 259. We'll read together the prayer for transfiguration. Let us pray. Holy God, upon the mountain you revealed our Messiah, who by his death and resurrection would fulfill both the law and the prophets. By his transfiguration, enlighten our path, that we may dare to suffer with him in the service of humanity, and so share in the everlasting glory of him who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever. Amen. Please be seated.
Thank you. Let us be in prayer. Holy God, our Heavenly Father, you are Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. You are the one who breathed into us the breath of life. In your Son, Jesus, you are the one who has saved us from our sin. In the power and the presence of your Holy Spirit, you are the one who guides and directs us into your paths of righteousness and holiness. You are our comforter, our counselor, the one who walks along beside us, guiding our footsteps, shining your light in our pathway. All praise and honor and glory and wisdom and majesty belong unto you and to you alone. In the midst of our thanksgiving, God, we are aware of our sin. We are aware that we fall short of your glory. We are aware that you are holy. We are unholy. We are aware, God, that in the presence of your righteousness, our sin is dark and black. And so we once again, God, ask that you would pour out your redemption and your forgiveness and your mercy upon us to cleanse us, that we might be white as snow, and to fill us with your new life. May we indeed become new creatures in Christ Jesus the Lord. We pray, God, for those who are listed in our bulletin. We pray for those that we lift up before you only in our heart, asking you to comfort the sorrowful in the morning, to give strength to those who are frail of mind, body, spirit, and soul, to undergird the lives of those who do not know you as Savior, and to stir up faith within them. Confirm our hope, O God. Use us to share the good news of Jesus Christ throughout our world. Let us be your hands. Let us be your feet. Let us be your mouthpieces. As we seek to draw closer to you, may others see Jesus in us. And may your light shine in our lives and through our lives. Make us the instruments of your peace, O God, in our world. Use us to be the instruments of justice and mercy. Use us to feed the hungry, to clothe the naked, to visit the sick and those who are imprisoned. Use us to declare the day of the Lord. Use us to declare that victory belongs to Jesus Christ. God, there are so many prayer needs, so many needs within our world, so many needs within our community, so many needs within our lives and the lives of our loved ones, that we simply lift ourselves up unto you, yielding ourselves more perfectly, seeking to obey your will more closely. We ask all of these things in the precious name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
As we prepare to give of our offering this morning, hear these words from 2 Corinthians. Remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each one should give what he has decided in his heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver.
Dear God, you are the source of light and love, and all things belong to you. You generally share with us the blessings of home, food, friends, and life itself. We ask that today you would receive a portion of what you have given us in this offering. May our gifts and joyful service strengthen your church, that we may share good news and compassion with those in need. Amen. Please be seated.
Good morning. Today's Old Testament lesson is from the book of Exodus, chapter 24, verses 12 through 18, the covenant confirmed. The Lord said to Moses, "Come up to me on the mountain and stay here, and I will give you the tablets of stone with the law and commands I have written for their instruction." Then Moses set out with Joshua, his aide, and Moses went up on the mountain of God. He said to the elders, "Wait here for us until we come back to you. Aaron and Hur are with you, and anyone involved in a dispute can go to them." When Moses went up on the mountain, the cloud covered it, and the glory of the Lord settled on Mount Sinai. For 6 days the cloud covered the mountain. And on the seventh day, the Lord called Moses from within the cloud. To the Israelites, the glory of the Lord looked like a consuming fire on top of the mountain. Then Moses entered the cloud as he went up on the mountain, and he stayed on the mountain for 40 days and 40 nights. The epistle lesson today is from 2 Peter. Chapter 1, verses 16 through 21. Making one's calling and election sure. We did not follow cleverly invented stories when we told you about the power and the coming of Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses on his majesty, for he received honor and glory from the God the Father, when the voice came to him from the majestic glory, saying, "This is my Son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased." We ourselves heard this voice that came from heaven when we were with him on the sacred mountain. And we have the word of the prophets made more certain, and you will do well to pay attention to it, as to a light shining in a dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. Above all, you must understand that no prophecy of Scripture came about the prophet's own intention and interpretation. For prophecy never had its origin in the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. This is the word of God for the people of God.
time for the children's word, and as they're going go to junior church, we'll sing 171. There's something about that name.
There's something about that name.
Thank you, choir. Talents and your gifts with us and with God, and thank you, melody makers, for sharing your gifts and your talents with us, and thanks to Deb for sharing hers as well. Good morning again.
Good morning.
It's good to see all of you with your bright, smiling faces today. You may remember that the season of Epiphany started back on January the 6th when we celebrated the coming of the Magi to Jesus. The coming of the Magi to the infant Jesus was the manifestation of God to all of the world, to everybody in the world. And the scripture passages since then, if we follow the lectionary, which I didn't do every Sunday, but the lectionary passages have focused upon how Jesus manifested himself to people, how he healed people, how he went about doing good, how he preached, and particular emphasis upon the teachings of the Sermon on the Mount in chapters 5, 6, and 7 of Matthew. Today we come to the last Sunday of Epiphany, also known as Transfiguration Sunday. As we have been thinking about how Jesus has manifested God in himself to our world, we come now to a time where Jesus took three of his disciples in the 17th chapter of Matthew, and he goes up to a high mountain. So Matthew chapter 7, verse 1, after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John, the brother of James, and led them up a high mountain by himself. Now, if we go back to the Old Testament period, it's particularly the passage that Dorsey read earlier from Exodus, we find Moses also going up on the mountain. Moses went up on the mountain in order to receive the law. Another place in the Old Testament we read about Elijah. Elijah was fleeing for his life from the prophets of Baal, and he fled to a mountain. And there he encountered God, not in the wind, not in the earthquake, not in the fire, but he encountered God hidden away in this mountain by a still small voice. There are other places in the Old Testament where it talks about people going up mountains. And in the Old Testament, going up to a mountain is a place where you encounter God. Do I need to use the handheld? Okie dokie. Thanks. Mountain is a way in which you encounter God. So as Jesus and the three disciples get ready to go up the mountain,
we have a clue. This is a place where they are going to encounter God. There's going to be a God encounter here, and that's our clue that there's going to be a God encounter, because they've gone to a mountain, a place where you encounter God in the Old Testament. Jesus, I'm sure, was familiar with that motif, and Peter and James and John, if they weren't familiar with it already, soon became familiar with that motif. We read along. Now, I'm actually going to skip down to verse 5. While he was still speaking, a bright cloud enveloped them. A bright cloud enveloped them. In the Old Testament, again, we read about how a cloud went before, during the daytime, went before the people of Israel as they were going about their journey during the Exodus event. We also read about how when Moses was up on the mountain, passage that was read earlier in Exodus, not only was he on the mountain, but Moses became enveloped by a cloud while he was up there. We also read about how Moses would go into the tent of presence, or the tent of meeting, the tabernacle, and while he was in there, a cloud would fill the meeting place. In Isaiah 6, Isaiah says, "In the year that King Uzziah died, I went into the temple, and there I saw the glory of God." A cloud represents in the Old Testament the glory and the presence of God. So here we have another hint, we have another clue that as Jesus is here on this mountain, the place where you encounter God, the presence and the glory of God appears in the cloud. So we have a clear understanding here by those Old Testament motifs that Jesus is encountering God the Father. And the presence and the glory of God the Father is there on this mountain with Jesus and the three disciples. Verse 2, "There he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became as white as the light." The idea for transfiguration there, or transformation there, is that the light that shone from Jesus was a light that shone from Jesus. It wasn't like a spotlight was shining down on him from an outside source. It was though the light was radiating from inside Jesus. From his very inner being, there was transformation. There was change. And Peter and James and John got to experience that change, that transformation that Jesus was experiencing there. Just then there appeared before them Moses and Elijah talking with Jesus. Moses was the great lawgiver. He went on that mountain in the passage from Exodus in order to receive the tablets of the Ten Commandments, the tablets of stone containing the Ten Commandments. He was the one who gave the law to the people of Israel. He was considered the great lawgiver and understood to be the great lawgiver. Elijah was considered to be the greatest of all of the prophets. And so when Jesus is here talking to Moses and to Elijah, it is as if the great law of the Old Testament and the greatest prophet of the Old Testament is confirming that Jesus has come as the new lawgiver, as the new great prophet, and yet Jesus transcends Moses and Elijah. He is even greater than Moses and Elijah. I'll come back to that in a little bit. They appeared with Jesus. Now, in the other gospel lessons that we read about, because this same story is told in the Gospel of Mark and in the Gospel of Luke, it says that Moses and Elijah were talking with Jesus about his departure. Now we've come to the 17th chapter of Matthew. And Jesus and his disciples have gone to Caesarea Philippi. Caesarea Philippi was north of Galilee. Bible scholars believe that Jesus had gone up onto Mount Hermon And Mount Hermon was even farther north than Caesarea Philippi. So Jesus, up on this mountain, is as far north probably as he traveled in all of his life, even beyond the boundaries of his country, nation of Israel. He is about 100 miles or so from Jerusalem. And he is going to leave the Caesarea Philippi area, and he is going to start his journey, his final journey towards Jerusalem, where he knows that he is going to encounter the cross. He has already given a hint to the disciples about that. And so as we put the three gospel writers together, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, we understand that Moses and Elijah was talking to Jesus about his departure, or the Greek term is the same term for exodus, his journey towards Jerusalem that will end in his crucifixion. William Barclay said that Jesus went up on the mount on this particular occasion in order to pray and to prepare himself for his journey towards Jerusalem that was going to end in his crucifixion. So Moses and Elijah are there talking with him about that. Moses and Elijah are there to confirm to Jesus that indeed his going to Jerusalem, his taking up the cross for your behalf and my behalf, is indeed the will of God in this particular circumstance and situation. And in this transfiguration event, not only is Jesus manifested in a mighty way towards the three disciples, but Jesus is also confirmed in his own mind and his own spirit that the cross does in fact lay before him. While he was still speaking, a bright cloud enveloped them, and a voice from the cloud said, "This is my Son whom I love. With him I am well pleased." You may remember that those are familiar words. Now, I started off by saying that Epiphany begins with the visit of the Magi on January the 6th. The very next Sunday after Epiphany begins, we celebrate the baptism of the Lord, where Jesus is baptized. And when Jesus is baptized, you remember that as he comes up out of the waters, a voice from heaven declares, "This is my Son with whom I am well pleased." So this voice that comes at transfiguration is the same voice and is the same message that Jesus received from God the Father at his baptism, confirming that not only is he greater than Moses and Elijah as the lawgiver and the prophet, but he is even more than that. He is even the Son of God who is willing to give his life on Calvary for you and for me. Listen to him. This is my Son. Listen to him. Peter was kind of surprised at what was going on. He wasn't really sure what was going on, and he kind of just blurted out, "It's good that we're here. Let's build three booths, one for you, one for Moses, and one Elijah. This is such a magnificent event, such a magnificent moment in our lives. Let's stay up here on the mountain for a while. We want to enjoy it." Well, it says that Peter didn't really know what he was saying. He didn't know what he was talking about because, as a matter of fact, Moses and Elijah disappeared and Jesus begins on the way down into the valley. But the voice says to Moses, or to James and Peter and John, "Listen to him." The disciples sometimes had a hard time listening to Jesus. But again, that is the same message for us to hear once again. Listen to Jesus. During the season of Lent, during the Sundays of Lent, I'm going to be preaching a series of sermons on prayer, and I'll come back to that theme about listening to Jesus, listening to God in our prayer life. But for now, it's just enough for us to be reminded that Jesus is God's Son, And as Jesus listened to Moses and Elijah there on the Mount of Transfiguration, so are we to listen to Jesus. And in the listening of to Jesus, our lives are transformed and changed. Paul, writing to the church at Philippi, said that Jesus did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but he emptied himself. He left the glory, he left the presence of God the Father to come down to live among us fully human and willing to give himself as a servant, submitting himself unto obedience even unto death upon the cross, Paul said. So listen to him. In this passage, we are reminded that even though Jesus shed the glory of heaven, God the Father has given him glory. God the Father has given him honor. And Paul reminds the church that all things are subjected to Jesus Christ. He emptied himself so that all things could be given into him and entrusted unto him. Therefore, have this mind in you, that which was in Christ. Paul wrote to the church at Rome, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind." I mentioned earlier that the transfiguration of Jesus was not like a spotlight being shone down upon him, but it was a light that shone from the inside of him, kind of like E.T. shining, you know, the bright light from his belly. If we are going to have a light shine from inside our lives, it is because we have allowed Jesus Christ into our lives and we have allowed him to make us new creatures. We have allowed him to transform our lives. And Paul writes to the church at Corinth that you and I are being changed from one degree of glory to another degree of glory. Moses went up on the mountain and encountered God. Elijah went up on the mountain and encountered God. Jesus and the three disciples went up on the mountain and encountered God the Father. But there was another mountain, the mount that we call Golgotha, or in Latin, Calvary. And as we come to that mountain to behold the crucified Christ, that our lives are changed and transformed. Bible scholars tell us that the transfiguration event is a prefiguring of the resurrection. As Peter and James and John caught a glimpse of the glory of Jesus Christ in this transfiguration event, so people saw the glory of the risen Christ in his resurrection. And in the second letter of Peter, the apostle wrote that as we beheld his majesty on the Mount of Transfiguration, so we will behold his majesty and his glory and his power and his might and his presence when he comes once again in glory. Because Jesus Christ seeks to transform and change our lives into his very likeness, we can dare this day to listen to him. Let us pray. So often, God, we want our lives to be different than they are. We long for that. We even pray for that. And yet so often we close our ears and we close our eyes so that your spirit is unable to do its transforming work in our lives. Help us, God, to be like cocoons who are willing to allow your spirit to change our spirits so that we might emerge as beautiful, freedom-loving butterflies in our world, flitting about, sharing your glory with all that we meet and with all who would see us. Again we pray that may they see Jesus in our lives May they see Jesus through our lives, because we have been willing to allow him to live, to reside, and to reign within us. May all things be done to your glory and to your honor. Amen.
Our hymn ascending is number 731, Glorious Things to Thee Are Spoken. Please stand as you're able and join in singing.
Now may the light of the transfigured Christ shine upon you, guide your journey, and bless you with God's warmth, joy, and peace as you proclaim the love of Jesus Christ by word and deed. Amen.
Amen.